We had different groups of people have their own living ways, own culture, own set of laws, which the constitutional makers thought it must be preserved. Yes, it must be preserved. And one of the ways they thought it can be preserved was through sixth schedule. See, when we talk of Assam, not of today, when you talk of Assam as 1950, we had Arunachal within it, we had Nagaland within it, we had Mizoram within it, of course Manipur and Tripura were the united entities, we had Meghalaya within it, but all these people had different cultures, had their different identity, had their different laws, had their different ways of administering justice. So the constitution makers thought we must give them autonomy so that they can, within the state, it's a mini constitution, where the constitution have said, it has a district council, or the sixth schedule has legislative power, it has executive power, it has judicial power. When I appear in the Supreme Court many a times on cases relating to sixth schedule, I remember a case I argued about the Shillong, because Shillong you will find it very difficult, complex. Some wards are part of tribal areas, some wards are not part of tribal areas, then how when they are part of tribal areas for certain purposes, again they are not part of tribal areas for certain other purposes, the then Justice Sinha, after hearing me for half an hour, he said, Mr. Hansaria, we have heard you half an hour, but to be frank, and he was very frank, sir, I have not understood anything, but it requires consideration to be admitted, so it's still admitted. So it's really a matter which for the rest of the country, it's very difficult to explain. When I appear for the district council, they say, oh, it's a municipal organization, how can you say all this? I say, no, it's not a municipality, it's not a panchayat, it's a constitutional body. You must recognize that. So you must make this feel that sixth schedule is not a limb of the state government, it's not a limb of the union government, it's its own independent constitutional status. Now, what is its constitutional status? Is it a part of the state government, is it depending on the state government, or it is dependent completely on the central government, or what? Now we find that in the district council, we have now 10 district councils in the country, 3 in Assam, now we have Karbi Anglong, Dima Assam and Bodoland. Again in Assam, we'll talk about it. There are different structures for the 3 district councils. Dima Assam and Karbi Anglong has one set of laws. Borderline has another set of laws. Meghalaya district councils have another set of laws. Arunachal, though was entirely not based, was part of sixth schedule in 1950, but in fact it was never part of sixth schedule. It was never administered under the sixth schedule. Similarly, Nagaland, though the entire Nagaland was part of sixth schedule as the constitution visualized in 1950, but it was in fact on ground never part of sixth schedule. The Mizoram, the whole of Mizoram was part of 6th schedule because it was a district under the state of Assam, Mizo district. But after it attained the statehood of the first United States under the Northeast Asia Reorganization Act 1971 and thereafter became a state, only 3 districts, part of the 3 districts in the southernmost part of the country, that state, are now the 6th schedule areas. So let us understand what is how the 6th schedule is operating in different areas. So far as Meghalaya is concerned, the whole of Meghalaya, including the Shillong town, except 3 wards of Shillong, which is called Normal Shillong, rest is Abnormal Shillong, and cantonment area, that is excluded from the 6th schedule, rest entire area of 6th schedule under the 6th schedule. However, the district councils under the 6th schedule have a very limited role. Again, they can make laws on paragraph 3, various subjects, agriculture, custom, marriage, etc., etc. But all laws has to be, has the assent of the governor. Now, the governor acts on the act and advice of the Council of Ministers. So ultimately, whatever the law they make, it has to be vetted through, it has to pass through, it has to be agreed by the Council of Ministers at the state. So virtually they are under the state, so far as Meghalaya district councils are concerned. Except for administration of justice, they have got different district council courts where both their parties are tribals. In a criminal case, of course it is against the state, but if the victim is a tribal, if the assailant is a tribal, it goes to the district council courts. It is a different way. The CRPC, CPC does not apply. It goes by the principles of equity, justice and good conscience. That's how it happens. Now, so far as Assam is concerned, We have got three district councils. Initially, two district councils were there, Dima Hasao and Karbi Angaon. Initially, it was called Biki Hills and not Kata Hills. But when I was reading, I didn't apply my mind that when state of Meghalaya was constituted under 244A by an autonomous state within the state, which is again a very peculiar state of affairs which was created, which was not visualized under the constitution. But with the demand of the people of Meghalaya, at that time the government thought, that was the agreement that within the state we have a state where we have a larger economy, a larger autonomy than the district councils. So Karbi Anglong, then the Biki Hills, and then North Kachar Hills, the Masa were given the option to join Meghalaya under the Assam, Meghalaya, and under the Meghalaya Reorganization Act 1969. But they did not join, so it remained part of Assam. Now, after it remained part of Assam, there are normally under the paragraph 3, there are 10 subjects, broad Sarihat subjects, on which they can make laws, the district council can make laws. But so far as the two district councils in Assam are concerned, the Dima Hasao and Karbi Anglong, they have got additional about 15 subjects which has been given to them by amendment of 6th schedule incorporating paragraph 3A, by which they have been given additional powers to legislate. Bodoland again, they have been given additional power to legislate on 40 additional subjects other than those mentioned, 10 subjects mentioned in paragraph 3. So it has a larger autonomy. But what is most important is, now all these laws again have to go through the assent of the governor. Governor again acts on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers, which again is the state government. The whole autonomy purpose, the purpose of whole autonomy goes. That's how. So far as the district councils of Assam are concerned, if the law contemplated under paragraph 3, the 10 subjects or 15 or 40 subjects mentioned in paragraph 3A and 3B falls under the concurrent list, the governor is required to take the assent of the president. So you are not under the control of the state government. You are under the control of the central government. Of course, we are all part of the central government. I heard my predecessor saying that whether we are part of India or not, I don't think it's a time to discuss whether we are part, under what part, whether Article 2 or Article 3. Today, we must accept that Darjeeling, of course, politically, whether you accept it or not, legally, as I understand, it's a part of the Union of India within the state of West Bengal. Now, we want more autonomy. We know, because, as I see, why the 6th schedule was there? Because there are different people with different tribes, with different customs, with different practices were there. Now, again, in West Bengal, Gorkhaland people staying in Gorkhaland, where with a different identity, with a different culture, with a different type of living, with a different laws to practice. So, we want an autonomy. See, the democracy, according to me, is not the majority. Majority always rules in the democracy. But how the majority has taken the care of the minority, the people who are not in the majority, whether they are happy with that minority, with the majority rule, that is the test of actual democracy. I always feel that whether, yes, in a majority country, if you have a majority, that government, how they have taken control of the people who are not in majority, that is the test of democracy. If the people who are not in majority take care of you, and if the people in minority, I'm not saying about linguistic, I'm not saying about religion, whatever way you can call it, are happy with that system, then that's the true test of democracy. Now, if we feel that they are not happy with the system, then comes autonomy to be given separately. Now, so far as the Gorkhaland is concerned, according to me, of course, you want a separate state, that's the best way to do it. Again, it's a big fight, political fight, it's not a legal fight. As my learned friend said, one that writ petition was filed in the Supreme Court, if somebody would have come to me, I would have said, please don't file it. If you file it, it gets rejected. It is very easy for the state government to say, for the central government to say, you have gone to court, you have got no case made out, even the Supreme Court rejected your petition. So, political issues should not never be gone to the court. And in otherwise also, I always advise you go to courts only as a last resort. Though it is against my profession, but then you must always go at the last resort, because if you are rejected there, then you are remedialess. Then you don't go anywhere else. So, you should go at the end. As I said, the district council definitely is a good option for the Gorkhaland to have autonomy to administer themselves. Presently, we have Gorkhaland Territorial Administration Act 2011. That's what I understand. But there is no legislative power. It is some administrative power. But again, by and large, everything is controlled by the state government. You are under the state government. So you must have a provision including yourself under the 6th schedule, for which, of course, constitutional amendment would be required. Can I have a glass of water, please? Constitutional amendment would be required for that purpose. But then, of course, politically, the constitution has to be amended. 244A was inserted, which was never visualized. All that you want to amend is 244, which includes to include West Bengal, and then in the 6th schedule, you have some part of the Gorkhaland area to be part of 6th schedule. There, the care has to be taken that the law made by the district councils of Gorkhaland would require not the assent of the governor, but the assent of the president. That takes care to a great extent your control under the state government. Perhaps that is the main difficulty. Perhaps people of Gorkhaland are not happy with the majority rule of the West Bengal. They feel, because I am not part of, I have visited there, and I am sure that I had my honeymoon there. So it's very dear to me, actually. So the people of that area feel that we are not taken care of by the majority rule of the West Bengal. We must have their own identity. We must rule ourselves. We are not feeling as if we are ruling ourselves. What is democracy? We rule ourselves. We the people. But people of that area feel that we are not ruling ourselves. So we must have an autonomy, at least in the day-to-day life, day-to-day administration. Agriculture, which is very important for our country. The land system, which is very important for our country. The primary education, which is very important for our country. The inheritance laws of inheritance, the customary laws are very important. All these laws can be made by the Gorkhaland Council. Let us put it that Gorkhaland Autonomous Council. Let us put it that it has come under the 6th schedule. What benefit we will get? First, we can make laws on various subjects. You must ask that you have given Bodoland to make laws not only on 10 subjects, 10 plus 40, 50 subjects, that's one. But there they say that only on subjects falling under the concurrent list require the approval of the president. You can say that no, all the laws made by us will go to the governor, but governor will take the assent of the president and he will go by the assent of the president. So it's not that you will be controlled by the state government. Otherwise, if it is up to the state government, many times I feel that I do a lot of cases for Meghalaya District Council. As I say that Meghalaya, the entire Meghalaya is a part of District Council. And that is, that have the maximum litigation perhaps, because the Shillong has more economically growth. So they have more litigation. Again, they feel that yes, for everything we have to depend on the state government, because the laws are made subject to the government. Again, the governor, another important thing is that the governor, whether it has a discretion or not. Earlier it was that, and the Supreme Court has also said, that the governor exercises no personal discretion except otherwise conferred. Now, because the governor under Article 163 of the Constitution, he has to act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. And why not under the 6th schedule when he acts? There was a debate that he does not act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers while acting under 6th schedule, but the Supreme Court has clearly said that no, he acts under the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. That's how the Constitution was subsequently amended in paragraph, I think 20BA and 20BB was incorporated, giving discretionary power on certain subjects to the governor, where he passes, when he exercises discretion on certain subjects, after consultation with the governor, with the state government, and with the consultation with the district councils. He exercises discretion. So you must, another thing which you must keep in mind while you have a political dialogue with the authorities, that when the governor acts, he acts in personal discretion, not on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. And you must note that on these subjects, at least, to start with, you must say that on all subjects, he must act in his personal discretion. That is the whole purpose of 6th schedule. Otherwise, he acts under the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers in the purpose of autonomy force. He must act under on the personal discretion. And he can consult the central, of course, the state government and the district councils. And there also, I find that so far as the district councils of Tripura and Mizoram are concerned, that the provision is the governor may discuss if necessary, if he thinks necessary. But so far as the district council of Assam is concerned, he must consult whenever he exercises personal discretion. These are all those small things. That's why I say that the four states which are governed by the district council today have different ways of application. Assam, it has more autonomy. Of course, maybe for a reason that in Assam, the two districts are only, a small part of state is kind of covered by the district council, so require more autonomy for themselves. That anything which the governor does, he must discuss with the, he must consult the state government and consult the district councils. But so far as Tripura and Mizoram are concerned, he may consult if it required. So that again is not acceptable. He must consult the district council. And Meghalaya is concerned. Meghalaya, almost all the laws are subject to the state government laws, so it does not apply. It has its autonomy, but if the state government makes a law on those subjects, even on those 10 subjects which are there, the state government laws prevail. The district council laws does not prevail. So these are 3, 4, 5 things which are there, and I would like more. I have generally explained. I would like more. If you have a questions on that subject, I would love to answer those questions. Again, the administration of justice is very important. You may have your own courts, but again, the courts without some regulations, you require some regulation, because recently I did a case where in the Supreme Court, a district council judge, he convicted a person under 302 for murder after 10 years of trial. And he said that no, he behaved very well in my court. I give him 7 years. How can you do it? That's the first question the court asked me. Mr. Hansaria, how can you justify this order? We went to the district and the High Court said, no, he is not a competent person, so we will transfer the case to a regular court. I said, alright, I cannot justify this order. It goes, must go back and he must decide the question of sentence or the cross or other procedural difficulties were there. But you cannot transfer to a court which does not have the competent jurisdiction. You cannot say that, no, this High Court has decided in one case wrongly, so I will transfer the cases from this High Court to other High Court. No, it cannot be done. Ultimately, Supreme Court accepted and it is stayed and it is up to its pending consideration further. So you must have also judicial remedy is very important. When again everybody says, everybody is fed up with thing, main tumko court mein dekh lunga. The people have confidence in the court. So again, unfortunately, present trend, we have difficulties with the Supreme Court. I don't want to go into that. But still, by and large, of all the organs of the government, legislature, executive and judiciary, people have, broadly speaking, more faith, let me put it that way, in the judicial system. So you must also have a good judicial system when you have discussed with the appropriate government about the district council concept. Because presently, the power of the judges are controlled broadly by the governor. Under the 6th schedule, they govern up to 7 years. The district, there are different district council courts if both the parties are scheduled tribe. But beyond 7 years, if you have to try, the governor must confer him power, otherwise he does not have. Of course, invariably in all cases he confers power, but why should you depend on the governor again to confer power? But you must have a system of selecting good people. You must have a selecting person who is capable people. He does not say, no, I like his face very good. Though he has committed a murder, I give him 7 years. No, this is not acceptable. This is not right. So judicial system also, as I said, that 6th schedule is not one. You can have your own way of 6th schedule. You come under the 6th schedule, you can have your own way, different stream of 6th schedule to be implemented in Gorkhaland. Of course, autonomy is required because, as I said, we are not happy with the majority ruling of the people there. And that's how the agitation is there. But one humble request, that's I always say, people don't like me saying that. I go to Assam, I come from Assam. I say, why do you go for bans? Who is suffering? Your people is suffering. My people is suffering. We had bans of 40 days. We have bans for 105 days. What has happened? The main sufferer, all right. As a tourist, I may have gone, I may have suffered. If I have a business, I may have suffered. But ultimately, the local people have suffered. The ban is not an answer, according to me. You must find out some alternative means. Ban affects the local people the most. They are having daily wages. People earn 200 rupees to 300 rupees to feed their family in the evening. If you have got even for a day, just see that perhaps they may have to sleep empty stomach. Please don't go for buns, maybe symbolic one or two. Other modes of protest has been given. Hunger strike is one of the very important rules. You have to affect yourself. One, Assam, I find that discount and reduce. I find that, oh, I'm a bondhan karta disu. What have you done? You just give a call. What's happened? I find that I'm going traveling. In one village, there is a bank. Again, ASU gives, another local students union gives one village in one district or a town or a village a bank. The entire traffic is blocked. What have you gained? And what are the bank policies have contributed to the system? Nothing. They are just playing cricket on the road. That's all. You have to suffer yourself. You have to fight. And in the fight, unless you suffer, you don't feel the pinch. Unless you suffer, the other person does not realize that no, you are really fighting for a good cause. Giving bond, according to me, is a very easy thing. But you must see the people who are suffering. So I request, humbly request, of course, many of you may not like it, my saying that you may not have bonds and all those things. What else can we do? Of course, you are a political person, you know various modes of protest, there are various other modes of protest, you can do it. As for the Supreme Court also, there are many lawyers, but you know, it's very common. In many districts, it is reduced substantially, but in Delhi also, many times, some lawyer is slapped, is given ban. What did it cost you? It cost the litigant the most. He has come all the way for an evidence, he has come all the way, he is in jail. For one day, we don't have judicial officer, even otherwise. One day, bun in a court means a lot to many people, not to the lawyers. Lawyers may have got their fee, may not have got their fee for the particular day. So, in the Supreme Court, for that purpose, we don't have buns at all. We had one, and me and Anunesha were the first persons to break it and go inside against the main person, saying that, all right, you may expel us from the Bar Association, but then bun we will not upset. So you must take that step and lead the people of that area. And I would love to be part of, helpful to you in any way I can. I can answer your questions now, I can answer questions later on at any stage of time. I'm thankful to you. I'm thankful to Gorkhaland.